Now, is not so allow us to modify our genome. A genome, it is a set of DNA, contains all genetic information about our being, and now we can, making alteration to this genome, we can intrude ourselves into the law of generation of the world. And now it is not any longer part of one cemented truth, but something that we can shape. And in light of these changes, I think it is crucial to look once again in the Orthodox account of the logoi of creation. And to deal with this question, I'm going first to look into the origin of this concept, and second, to look how this concept is developed in the work of the Romanian theologian Dmitru Staniloae, his book Orthodox Spirituality. So, first, origin of the Christian use of the term logoi. The concept of logoi is usually associated with Maximus the Confessor, and he developed this concept in the 7th century. And what he does, he actually is comment on a difficult text of one of theological orations from Gregory of Nazianzus, containing the words, "We being a portion of God and flow down from above." This word actually has been appropriated by the originists, and this word origin held that there were intellectual beings, they were originally gathered around God, and because of the excess of contemplation of God, they move away from Him, and therefore they sin. So, as a result of it, according to Origen, the world was created as a pedagogical institution for the redemption of intellectual creatures. Now, Maximus wonders, in what way are the words of the theologian being correctly understood? Because as you all know that, the concept of origin of pre-existence of the soul was condemned in 550, and Maximus is writing 1500 years after. Of course, Maximus could not accept that the venerable father was guilty of heresy. To him, therefore, it was not an option to understand this word in the sense that intelligences has existed before as actual individual in two phases. So what to do? Well, so he think, to be a portion of God perhaps means that God knows all things before creation. That kind of works. And he knows creation as his own act of will before the ages. And thus Maximus developed the concept of logoi. And he called his will logoi to show that what he speaks about, it's about God's eternal self-contemplation. It is not about created world. And then the word slipped down from above, according to Maximus, had to be interpreted as the referring to the historical form of man, and in which a human being lives not in accordance with his logos and God. And the important thing that Maximus distinguished the taxonomic order of creation from and the laws of nature and essences distinguished from divine will and logoi. So logoi are principles on the divine level, and essences is something created by this logoi, and taxonomy, and universal, something created by this logoi. So now I come to Staniloae's account. What Staniloae does, so Staniloae begins by building the taxonomic order of logoi within creation. And as you see, he refers to St. Maximus, but he is also very much influenced by the French philosopher Maurice Blondel, his work, L'Action. he argues, you see that there is one general logoi and particular logoi. And we need to subordinate the particular logoi to general. And the most general logos is a divine logoi. So it is in your text, it's written in bold. Every tendency in us has its logos, thus its apparent justification. The more general logos is like the top of the pyramid compared to a particular one. And then he said, in the measure in which we raise ourselves to ever more general logos, we become more virtuous and approach the most general supreme logos. And the most general supreme logos is the divine logos. So that by working in conformity with the general logos, we reach happiness. And then Staniloae's argument is threefold, and this is in Hansel. First, he argues that each part is determined by the whole universe and vice versa. Second, he says spiritual and physical orders are working together. And third, only taking into consideration the natural possibilities and laws of nature, we can use it. Then, you once again have the text in bold. He refers to Marise Blondel arguing that the work of man too has adapted himself to the secret of natural powers in order to also adapt them better. And then he said that actually Maximus the Confessor formulated the truth long ago. And that the created universe, in the created universe, there are hidden divine logos, and technical civilization gradually discovers the energies of nature and the laws of their utilization. Right. So there are four things in this text. I want you to pay attention. First, Staniloae associates the divine logos with the energies of nature and the laws of their utilization. Second, the process of discovering of logos by technical sciences and acting in accordance with natural laws and subordination of particular to general, he describes the process of divinization. And then, providential work of God is done through the physical movement of the world and human spirit that seeks and finds. And when he speaks about the dynamic, the movement of God's creation, he thinks that each of us participates in this movement in order to reach the union of God. And the concept, the concept of logoi actually could help to convert people and worked very well when it was taken for granted that there exists eternally valid propositions or universal. It was conceived like a part of the cemented truth, cemented reality. And then when we linked the universe to logoi, that is clear for people that it was their encounter. This is Christ himself. But nowadays, in the context of recent discoveries and post-truth world that we are speaking about, nowadays, the concept no longer works in this particular form. And if you link logoi with universals and people do not longer believe that universals are actually universals, then there's a problem. They say we no longer believe in Christ, which is actually not necessarily connected. What Staniloae does in his work, he merges two things. He merges the natural laws and divine predestination, and he identified the dynamic of nature and the process of divinization. And first, how can we answer it? When we think about God's forethought about creation, what we can say for sure is that God, it was a part of divine revelation that God's design does not agree with natural law. Let's think about resurrection. We know that God has granted us eternal life. And that contradicts the fact that nature works according to the second law of thermodynamics, and it leads to entropy and leads to death. In spite of this fact, we are given eternal life, which is not consistent, and it is part of God's design, which is not consistent with natural law. And also think about the incarnation or the conception of Theotokos. That fact also is not consistent with natural law. And also in baptism, if you think about baptism, if we remember what St. Basil writes about baptism, that we are baptized into death of Christ, and that death means that we need to die for ourselves, because now our lives goes into a different direction. So if you run a marathon and you run one direction, and then you need to turn and run to a different direction. So he gives this comparison. And even if we think about us as being members of church and being one with the body of Christ, then we can say that we are grafted to Christ. So we are no longer outworking our human capacities, but we become a new creation. And also it is in the Bible, in the Bible and Old Testament, God said, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, and neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so my ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts are higher than your thoughts." And in the New Testament, Christ said that, "But take heart, I have overcome the world." And thus, he already reveals to us freedom. So we can also ask ourselves, is Christian life is really acting in accordance with the natural laws? And that's going in line with nature takes us closer to divinization. And because if we follow nature, we plunge into struggles of survival, and our highest good can be seen as reproduction. And monastic culture, if you think about monastic culture, is not at all about that. And the next point is scientific discovery of God's will. So I also ask, it is in Staniloae's account, the discovery of the energies of nature and the laws of their utilization is the discovery of logoi. So, of course, we spoke already about the limitation of science. And I think the good comparison is if you compare the universe with the Lego, so there are lots of building blocks and they can be built together. So what science does, it discovers how we can build together the building blocks. But if you think about God's pre-eternal design, it's about God's knowledge, what is going to be built from this Lego. And this knowledge already includes freedom. And the last thing is God's moving of creation, or God's moving of creation is substituted by the movement of God's creation. And my concern is there is a risk that the process of movement itself becomes divinized. And the structure, it regards human nature as a small particle of this big movement. And God is something like impersonal universal principle and not personal. But of course, Staniloae would never say this. So Staniloae would argue it is not. So, and that is why I come to a conclusion that this observation shows that now, in light of the current changes in our outlook, it is crucial to refine or to redefine, or maybe define more clearly, the concept of logoi within Christian Orthodox theology, because if freedom is our recent discovery, God has forethought about creation, included freedom before all ages. Mulțumesc.
On Christian legacy. Thank you very much. Some questions?
Yes,
please.
Yes. Okay, Olga, thank you. Quite fascinating. I have two questions, if I may. The first one is regarding this logoi, general logoi, and so on. I wonder how much was, you know the concept of Justin Martyr and his logoi, logoi spermaticoi, and so on. He came up with this idea already in the second century. So I wonder if Gregory of Nazianz or Staniloae, if they reflected Justin Martyr's ideas, if it's the same, or what is the shift, if there is a shift from his or ideas. Because from what you told us, it really sounded like Justin Martyr.
Mm-hmm.
So just, but I don't know, just asking. And and secondly, and this bothers me a little more, you know, this idea of God's design versus natural laws and how God's design actually goes against natural laws. I wonder if in this view, if we hold this view, if we are not underestimating the value and beauty of God's creation, whether we don't understand salvation then as a negation of creation and sort of fleeing from creation into a more perfect realm or whatever, and it's a bigger theological question, obviously, but mortality is this not God's design? Well, certain theologies would say so, that mortality is not God's original design. Other theologians would say that mortality is part of God's creation for the time being, that we were not created immortal, but rather for eternal life with God, but mortality was the original plan of God. So, I know this is maybe a big idea, but it seems to me as if also the other passage that you quoted, this overcoming the world, you know, what is Jesus actually saying? I have overcome the world. So does he mean the world in the positive sense or the negative sense, in the sense of sin? Because the world can have different meanings in the Bible. Sometimes, you know, God comes to save the world. So John can say very positive things about the world. God's Son is saving the world through his incarnation and death and resurrection. And then friendship with the world is means that we are enemies to God. Wow, so that must be a different way of understanding the world. You know, so, and again, if we look at in the scriptures, are the scriptures using the same term for the world? Or is it a different, you know, cosmos, or is there another term for the world? I would contend in this place, overcoming the world is not overcoming the world in terms of its natural limitations as created realm, but rather overcoming the world of sin, but not world of limitations. Limitations is not sinful. We are created limited so that we learn to live by faith in God. Now that's a perhaps different philosophical understanding. So, what I sense in some of these theologians, let's make a summary of my comments, sorry for taking so long. I sense that there is an underappreciation of God's creation and this attempt to flee, you know, to overcome the necessary limitations of our creation, including mortality. You know, and I think this may be wrong, perhaps. So, what are your thoughts on this?
I think there are several things in this. Of course, what are we talking about? we are talking about of changing perception of who we are. So we are not talking about our overcoming some limitations, but the modern, our understanding of the world becomes more nuanced at the moment. But if we understand, now we explore freedom, so we encounter different realities that we did not pay attention to before. And that does not change the content of divine revelation. The divine revelation remains the same, but we just looking back into it, we understand it fully. And regarding that we deny, I don't see how we deny the beauty of the world. Nowadays, the concept of logoi is used to say that there is meaning to the world. And this is beautiful. And also the concept of logoi is used in Orthodox, Christian Orthodox discourse about economy, about ecology in creation, that we need to be particularly careful to bless the world because everything is filled with divine logoi. But I do not think there is a need to appeal to divine logoi and to divinize parts of creation. So, because it's not of denying of creation, but it's about presuming that creation is partly divine. When the there's no separation between divine and creation, that is the problem. But it's still, you can still speak about the beauty of creation without saying that it is that the laws of the universe are part, are actually Christ.
Mm-hmm. But in what way does God's design contradict natural laws?
I don't want to say that God's design contradicts natural laws. I just want to say it's much broader and much more beautiful that we can we can understand or we can explain. We do not need to only to say. We can associate with natural laws, but we do not need to say God design is natural laws. It is natural laws and something else, and freedom. Exactly, I am very positive about changes in the modern world because I think when it was believed that it is one cement of truth. And I spoke with Catherine about this yesterday, that together with this cement of truth, actually, it was also a divinization of nature, it was a divinization of reason, and now, when we no longer believe, the old idols of the 18th, 19th centuries are also falling apart. And what we encounter with this freedom is we encounter there is a possibility. Truth is not something absolutely defined, and it's not a cemented truth, but it's a living one, and this living truth is Christ.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. The next question from Dominic Salama.
Actually, it's something that I want to first thank you for the really academic approach to the whole thing. My question relates to something Mike brought up with it. I heard, if I were right, in the process of talking about natural law, and correct me if I'm wrong, you mentioned that the death, the fact that we die, is against natural law, or what's the fact of, when you mentioned that the reference to us human beings, is it both body and soul, or one body only? That's because you mentioned something about the fact that something about natural law in the body that well, when we die, if we resurrect, that will be against natural law. Is there is death only does it not refer to nobody only, then immortality would be essentially from the beginning were created and designed by God to be immortal, but in the immaterial sense?
What I said, we do not link, reduce our ideas to what science explores, because according to science, what science tells us that our life is subject to death. And we cannot reduce God's design to this what technical civilization explores, because if we follow what is said by science, then our life is subject to death. But as Christians, so we have a different revelation about our destiny, and one of the revelations is we know that we expect the eternal life.
Thank you very much for your questions. Yes, please.
Hello, I would like to congratulations for your presentation. My question is, especially in the Stoic philosophy of ancient Greece, we tackle the same problems of divinization of nature, the divine logos, the problems between freedom and fate, and all this. Do you see some similarities or influences of ancient Greek philosophy towards the most Christian problem of logoi, or in the same problematic? Thank you.
What I wanted to say that exactly we know more about logoi now. So if Stoics perception was about logos thematicus, so divine reason, which that penetrates the universe. So it was, if you think about Hellenistic perception, it's God was presumed as invisible ground of the earth, and it's kind of penetrated the whole universe. We Christian believe it's no longer the truth. So God is beyond the universe, so he has created, but there is a certain contingency within the universe. So God is not connected to laws, to natural laws of the universe. So although he created the natural laws, but he is not limited by.
Thank you very much for your question. Olga, do you think that God created natural law, or it is just from human?
Absolutely, I believe that God created natural law. I just want to say that there is a part of divine revelation that maybe we will discover that eternal life is part of natural laws in the future, but nowadays we do not believe this. So nowadays, according to natural laws, our life is subject to death. And we know that God's design of human is broader than that.
In this case, do we have the right to modify, deconstruct this creation, the issue of natural law?
Exactly. What I say that why we cannot link God's eternal design to natural laws, because now it used to be linked by Stoics, by Greek philosophy, but now we no longer can say that there are different arguments against this, but one of the arguments is because we know that we are free to modify the set of DNA, our genome, then we can't, we no longer can, because genome is exactly a logos thematicus. It's very close at least to logos thematicus of Stoics. So if we can modify this now, we cannot say that this is a principle, this is God incarnate. Because then we modify God in time.
Yes.
That would be, we can say.
Thank you very much. No questions. Thank you.